Okay, this is an article from the Orange County Register, which I normally don't even look at, but I thought this was interesting. Distrust among San Onofre nuclear workers remains. San Onofre Nuclear Generating Station is on the southern coast of California in the city of San Clemente. The troubled work environment at San Onofre Nuclear Generating Station has improved substantially in some areas, but needs more work in others, according to an inspection report released Monday by the Nuclear Regulatory Commission. In 2010, the NRC issued a chilling effect letter to San Onofre, highlighting deep distrust between some employees and plant management. Fear of retaliation made some workers reluctant to report safety concerns to their bosses, even though plant workers as a whole made nearly 10 times more safety complaints than the mid-range for the industry. The plant, which has also been under scrutiny for weaknesses in human performance and problem-solving, has also seen improvement there, but more remains to be done in this area as well. In April and May, San Onofre's operator, Southern California Edison, hired outsiders to measure its progress in improving its safety-conscious work environment. There was good news and not so good news. When asked, "Are there any conditions under which you would be hesitant to raise a safety concern?" nearly one quarter of the workers said yes in 2010. By the spring, that number had been sliced in half, with only 12% of employees answering yes. And while that was a big improvement, there was some backsliding as well. When asked, "Have there been any instances in which you or another individual experienced a negative reaction for raising a safety issue?" only 11% of workers said yes in 2010, but 19% said yes this year. The NRC determined that further improvement was needed at SONGS to eliminate perceptions of fears of retaliation for raising safety concerns. In one of the assessments, 77% of focus group participants said the safety-conscious work environment at San Onofre was improving, and only 1% said it was declining. Although virtually everyone expressed a willingness to raise a safety concern via one or more of the available avenues, there was a need for continued or additional actions to address the hesitation by some personnel to do so. "None of this poses a risk to public safety?" plant and federal regulators stressed. "The feds just want the plant's culture to open up before anything serious happens." Well, thank you for that. Thank you for lying through your teeth, telling us that none of this poses a risk to public safety. If you can't go to your boss and raise concerns because you're worried about retaliation, that is a public safety risk. Okay. So I'm going to get down here. They did hire new management. Don't know anything about him. They tout him as being quite the man for the job. Has a good track record for improving things. I hope that is true. I hope he has children. Because, yeah. Anyway, I'm not going to get into my rant anymore. Here's the perceptions of retaliation in the independent safety culture assessment. "Are you willing to raise a safety concern?" In 2010, 98% said yes, and in 2011, 99% said yes. "Are there any conditions under which you would be hesitant to raise a safety concern?" 2010, 23% said yes, and in 2011, 12% said yes. "Have there been any events or circumstances in the last year that have reduced your willingness to identify or raise safety issues?" In 2010 and 11, 8% both said yes. Have there been any instances in which you or another individual experienced a negative reaction for raising a safety issue? 2010, 11% said yes. 2011, 19% said yes. So, am I supposed to feel safer about all of this just because the NRC says it's all okay? 19% of the employees there said yes. There had been instances in which they or another experienced a negative reaction for raising a safety issue. These numbers should be zero. Zero. Results from the April 2011 Safety Culture Survey. Percentages indicate respondents who agreed or disagreed with the statement. A neutral response was also available. Well, of course they're going to throw in some kind of BS neutrality. Of course they are. Anyway, even at 6% here and 11% here, there is free flow of information in which issues are raised and addressed. 11% no, disagree. Wow. Sad. Still really, really sad. And I'm sure that this is more the norm than not, right? I mean, let's face it, this is just one out of how many that we have in the United States? So while that is a little disheartening, there's another article about the tritium leaks that have plagued San Onofre. This was from June 28th, 2011. Tritium, a radioactive form of hydrogen, has leaked from at least 48 of 65 nuclear power plant sites, including the one closest to Orange County. While most leaks have been found within plant boundaries, some have migrated off-site, but none is known to have reached public drinking water supplies. Okay, in 2006, tritium leaked in the groundwater beneath the San Onofre nuclear generating station, prompting the temporary closure of one drinking water well in southern Orange County. Test revealed no detectable radioactivity and the well was returned to service. If tritium is leaked into groundwater, drinking water well, how could it not be detected? How could it not? And 2 years ago, it was found in the ocean off the coast of San Onofre, which is a huge surfing spot right there. And the joke has been from day one is that you go surfing down at San Onofre and you come out glowing green. So the tritium was detected in one ocean water sample at a level below the prior. Wasn't that nice of them to make us feel like everything is just so safe? Okay, it's business as usual all over the world, especially in the United States. San Onofre makes and releases some tritium. The tritium is bound up as one of two hydrogen atoms on a water molecule. Water naturally contains a little tritium, and San Onofre contributes a small amount to the local ecosystem. Well, thank you for doing that without my approval. The amount of tritium released is too small to measure once it enters the local environment. I find that very hard to believe. The radiation dose to humans from these tritium releases is also too small to measure, but it can be calculated as less than 0.001 millirem per year. These limits are safe and in accord with the Nuclear Regulatory Commission and the Environmental Protection Agency. National Council on Radiation Protection and Measurements, and international guidance. Tritium is commonly used in self-luminous watches, in self-luminous exit signs, and self-luminous aircraft safety devices. That's not very threatening. Well, I guess this really isn't any more of a big deal than the fluoride that's in our water and the chemtrails that are dropping aluminum on us and the salmonella that's in the turkey that isn't regulated like it should be. You know, let's just, I could go on and on and on. So just for today, I thought that I would try to expose some of this. There is one issue that is on our side. Any exposure to radioactivity, no matter how slight, boosts cancer risk, according to the National Academy of Sciences. Federal regulators set a limit on how much tritium is allowed in drinking water. So far, federal and industry officials say that tritium leaks pose no health threat. But it's hard to know how far some leaks have traveled into groundwater. Tritium moves through soil quickly, and when it's detected, it often indicates the presence of more powerful radioactive isotopes that are often spilled at the same time. All right, I can't read anymore. I'll put the links if you want to read some more. God bless.